Namaste. As a part of our series, Psychoanalysis and Philosophy, today we shall discuss Immanuel Kant. Immanuel Kant is considered to be one of the most profound philosophers of the Western civilization. His works on science, working of the human mind, and ethics opens up interesting implications for psychoanalysis. However, the topic being so complex, very few people have explored it in detail. But Kant happens to be a favorite of our psychoanalysis consultant, Mr. Himanshu Vaidya. So, Mr. Vaidya, will you discuss this topic with us today?
Yeah, sure. Good to be here.
Namaste.
Namaste.
Yeah. What were the central areas of concern for Immanuel Kant?
Immanuel Kant worked on many areas of philosophy. Three areas which were important to him are, first, the concept of knowledge. Second, the concept of law. And third, the concept of morality. In the first one, Kant goes into the aspects of how do we know anything? How does the mental process operate? We may be trying to know something in the external world or the internal world, but essentially there is a process of knowing involved. And what is this process of knowing? That is one. And this is what we call the epistemological part of Kant. How does knowing happen? What is the process of knowing? Second element of this area is, what is the scope of knowing? Is there something called unknowable? Or is everything open to knowing? Does human mind have a limit beyond which it cannot go? Or is it just an open free for all where perfect knowing is possible? So this was the second concern, that is there a limit to human knowing? And what is this limit determined by? And the same question was taken up later by Wittgenstein in a linguistic manner, but Kant takes it up in a psychological sense. The third is the concept of morality. That if we don't want a reward punishment based morality, which finds its foundation in religion and God, both of which are matters of belief and not a matter of consensus, then if we want to have a rational morality based upon conviction, then what should that morality be founded upon? What is the foundation of that morality? And is morality necessary and possible at all? So these three, the concept of knowledge, the concept of morality, and the concept of law. The concept of law is very important. In fact, this was a starting point for Immanuel Kant. It is starting his major work, The Critique of Pure Reason. Because he was deeply disturbed by work of Hume, the philosopher before him, to whom he was responding. And Hume had suggested that we never see what we call the laws of science or laws of economics or laws of sociology. All that we call law in our knowledge, and we are so proud of, because we are not so proud of information that we have, that water boils at 100 degrees C and something else boils at 150 degrees C. But we are very proud of the law that we know, that liquid boils when heated. So he says that we are not so much proud about information, but about laws that we know and what is at the root of science, maybe exact science or inexact science. And the root of any science is the concept of law. And law is something in the area of knowledge we are all proud of. His question was, are these laws really reliable? Because these laws are not something that we have directly seen. What we have seen is phenomena. And from many phenomena, we have deduced a pattern. And we have deduced something that we see in all these phenomena, and we believe that is the cause of this phenomena, and we believe that we have found the right cause, and the cause is immutable, eternal. And therefore, we believe our science is absolute and eternal. We don't believe that law of gravity will stop working after 50 years. We believe it is going to be eternal, and one after another, as the civilization goes on, we keep adding to law one after the other, and we believe we are moving towards perfection of knowledge. And Hume says that these inferences that we have drawn and we have created laws out of them, they offer us no guarantee of eternity. They offer us no guarantee that they are not in perpetual danger of violation. They offer us no guarantee that they are the cause and nothing else is the cause. And this skepticism of Hume was something which eroded or shook at least the basis of all science. So Immanuel Kant's concern was how to find a sure foundation for science and sure foundation for everything that we believe in a scientific sense. So these three were the concerns of Immanuel Kant. First, the concept of knowledge. Second, the concept of law. And the third, the concept of morality. And all these concepts have a bearing on psychoanalysis. Of course, only if we take the trouble to discover and create those bearings. The concept of knowledge of how we know things, what are the limits of knowing, is very important in the psychological area as it is important in any other area. The concept of law brings us to the idea of psychic determinism versus postmodernism. And the concept of morality brings to us the emergence of superego, or the being born with a superego, and the entire zone of the significance of superego for individual and collective life. So all these three have a very strong bearing on psychoanalysis. Unfortunately, we have not really worked adequately on integrating Kant and his major work into psychoanalysis.
How can we relate Kant's epistemology in psychoanalysis?
Kant's, one of the central contributions is this epistemological process, the process of knowing. And the process of knowing also sets a limit to what can be known, the scope of knowing. And therefore, this process of knowing is very important, because the process of knowing not only tells us how we know, but it also tells us how far can we know. And this is very important, because this sets the scope of knowledge, the scope of human knowledge at least. And it also bears upon the concept of unknowable. Because if we divide the entire psychological realm into three parts, the known, the unknown, and the unknowable, questions arise where there is something called unknowable, or is it just unknown and the known? And from the known, we can always infinitely march into the unknown and know the whole of the unknown. So this fundamental question is a question as important for any other area as much it is for psychoanalysis. Now, Kant's process is important to know, how he looked at the process of knowing. And he says, it starts with the stimulus. That there is a stimulus in the external environment. For example, if I take this inhaler, the light which is falling on it is reflecting and falling on my eyes. My hands are holding it, so I have a sense of touch. So data is going into my brain from my eyes, from these two fingers. There is some olfactory sense, so my nose is also providing data. If it was making some sound, my ears would also provide some data. And if it was something edible, my tongue would also provide some data. So there would be stimulus from the object. That there is an object in the external environment and there is a stimulus. And this stimulus falls on my body, and my body has something called senses. Senses which can register this stimulus. and when senses related to one object come into the brain through different channels, in the brain somehow there is a coordinator. So at the same time, if we are looking at three different objects, there is no confusion in coordinating the all the sensory different five stimuli related to one object. So if I am touching two different things, there is no confusion that this stimuli and this stimuli would go to this stimuli. It doesn't happen that way. So there is some coordinator. So the stimuli is coordinated. The stimuli gets converted into sensations, and the sensations are coordinated into perceptions. So I perceive this as it is, the inhaler. And then the knowledge component comes in. The recognition happens at the level of perception. But then the knowledge component comes in, and it tells me what is it all about, what is its function, how was it made, how far to use it, and so on. So he calls it conception. And then happens knowledge, and then happens wisdom. So he puts out this process: stimulus leading to sensation, leading to perception, leading to conception, leading to knowledge, leading to wisdom. And this is Kant's central epistemological process. Now the point is, I cannot have any knowledge without undergoing these points of sensation, perception and conception. The mind cannot overleap the process of knowing. So Kant says there is no knowing possible by overleaping the process of knowing. We cannot overleap the process of knowing. And whatever are the limitations of this process of knowing are also the limitations of our knowing. So if there is a stimulus which I cannot register, so there are many sounds human beings can't hear, but dogs can hear. There are many lights we cannot see, but the owl can see. So there may be objects that you and I don't see, but the owl sees. Similarly, if there is an earthworm whose eyes are not as developed as our eyes are, there are many colors and forms he cannot see. So he says the knowing is limited by the process of knowing. And the process of knowing has its obvious limitations. There are limitations of senses, there are limitations of sensation, of perception, of conception, and there is no way to break free from this. Now, this is very important that we take hold of this process. Limitations is the second area, we can deal with it later in the psychoanalytic area. But if we just take this core process of knowing, of sensation, of stimuli, sensation, perception, conception, and knowledge, and wisdom, and we put it in psychoanalysis, and let us say we apply it to a person having intense anger and fear towards his boss at work. So the moment he sees the boss at work, right, the boss becomes the stimuli. And then the sensation process happens, perception process happens, and when the conception process is about to happen, lot of anger and fear related to father comes in. So what we call transference, right? Transference essentially is happening at the stage of conception. And then wrong knowledge happens that the person is going to attack me. And wisdom does not happen, insight does not happen that this is transference at work. And therefore, when we apply the core epistemological process of Kant into psychoanalysis, whether it is transference, whether it is counter-transference, whether we are talking of the Oedipal phenomena, how does the knowing happen, that process of psychic operation happen? The child sees the parent of the opposite gender and attraction develops. What happens inside of it? We have never gone into the manufacturing of the phenomena. We have gone to the phenomena. We say an Oedipal thing happens. The split is open. because of lack of self object, the ego is disintegrating, the self is disintegrating. But we have never gone into the manufacturing process of these phenomena. So if we go one step lower into the manufacturing process of this phenomena, we will have to use some sort of epistemological tool. And in the area of epistemology, Kant's central sequence and his work of what are the core ingredients, raw materials involved in human thinking. Some of them are quality, quantity, space, time, motion, stability, right? And there are many others, there is a whole list. But if we can use this, because these are the entities without which human thinking cannot happen, no matter which area we are talking about. And therefore, psychoanalysis becomes one of those areas where inevitably we are using this. So if we put the Kant's epistemological knowledge there, we can go into the manufacturing process of each of the important psychoanalytic phenomena, which we believe is the phenomena responsible for the root of pathology. We can also go for creation of healing phenomena in therapy. So that can be understood more deeply by using epistemology. And we can go into the raw materials, the four elemental entities involved in the psychological operations. And then we can develop some tools for those core fundamental entities. If you look at my model of the mind heat, it does precisely this. It applies epistemology to psychoanalysis and goes into the elemental entities which are involved in all these operations. And I think we have discussed before that two core entities which are involved in all of the psychological operations, they happen to be very important from pathological standpoint. They happen to be negativity and powerlessness. Because when we apply epistemology and we come deeper and we go into the raw ingredients, the core elementals of pathology creation, usually we end up into negativity and powerlessness. That if some phenomena was not negatively perceived, further pathology would not develop. There's some negativity involved. Something is negatively thought of. Either it's a negative event you are apprehending or some negative thing you think you are doing, but there's some negative entity somewhere which is apprehended. And then there is powerlessness not to overcome this negativity. And these two are at the root of most of the pathological phenomena that we see. And then if this is so, can we create tools to address these core issues? And then work upwards if we can. Or maybe we revisit the phenomena, we get the person into the phenomena psychologically and emotionally, and then we operate these two levers with those tools. But these are the options that open up before us if we apply Kant's epistemological process to the core critical psychoanalytic phenomena, which we believe are responsible for pathology or responsible for healing in therapy.
Can we use the central elemental concept of Kant's epistemology in psychoanalysis?
Yes, we can. And as I said, we can use it to have explain the four pathological phenomena, maybe the Kleinian split, maybe Jung's disturbance of the ego self axis, maybe Freud's Oedipus, Kohut's disintegration of self, Davalo's torturous and murderous rage which is pent up inside. We can apply this to any important psychoanalytic phenomena or tools of psychoanalytic therapy. There are not many standardized tools actually, except for a few that we keep passing on in supervision, but whatever tools are there, in fact, we have to create a full toolkit, which nobody has done actually, but whatever tools we have, whatever standardized cargo that we have, understand that in more elemental terms using this process. And then once you understand, you can always refine, you can innovate, you can borrow from other areas of spirituality, of other forms of therapy, and enrich this area in terms of both pathogenesis and healing.
Is Kant's moral imperative the same as Freud's superego?
Oh, very interesting. In fact, Freud had read Kant. And therefore, when Freud discusses conceptualization of superego, how superego develops, when it develops, and so on, he uses Kant's favorite phrase of the categorical imperative. Because Kant used this phrase to say that regardless of how wrong we do something, there is a sense inside that we are doing something wrong. That categorical moral imperative always is there. It is inborn. So Freud uses the phrase categorical imperative in his discussion of the superego. But Freud's superego is not the same as Kant's categorical imperative. Freud's superego is not inborn. Kant's categorical imperative is inborn. One. Freud's superego emerges at the end of the Oedipus. It is not inborn. Kant's categorical imperative is inborn. Two, Freud's superego is largely utilitarian at the service of survival and partly under compulsion when we talk of the ego ideal. Whereas Kant's categorical imperative is far more noble and almost spiritual in its flavor and content. You don't see the utilitarian flavor or the compulsive flavor in Kant's categorical imperative. Third, Freud does not see superego as something to be really developed in a particular way for greater good of the community in a social sense of the term. He does not go on to theorize what we can do with the superego to create a better society. And he also talks about balancing the superego with the demands of the id. Whereas for Kant, superego is almost like an ideal. And he is very clear that it is duty over beauty. And it's ideal over pleasure. And for him, the greatest general good can be achieved only by that way. And pleasure, therefore, has a much lower scope in his acceptability compared to Freud. Freud was afraid of repressing the id too much, leading to neurosis. Kant doesn't seem to think that way. And he is perhaps more positive about the capability of the human mind to repress or sublimate or transform the id and be far more moral than what Freud suggests. So there is a difference between the two of them.
Can you elaborate on what interesting issues would come up when Kant's concept of the thing in itself is considered in psychoanalysis?
Yes, it's very interesting, the thing in itself concept. What Kant says is that if I look at this inhaler, I know what it is based upon what my senses tell me. Now, this leads to an interesting question in two ways. One, how many senses do I have? Suppose there is an organism on this planet who does not have the sense of sight. He would know something, right, without the visual aspect. That does not mean what he is seeing does not have color. It has color, but that organism cannot see color because it does not have the sense to see that color. And he may believe that what he is seeing actually is colorless. But actually that is not colorless. Now that can go on. You take this logic forward. Then let us say some organism from Jupiter comes and he looks at something and he sees some quality of what we see. But he sees something because he has, instead of 5 senses, he has, let us say, 15 senses. And he sees many other aspects which we, you and I don't see. And this logic can go ad infinitum. That if you have 1,000 senses, I can always put this logic and say, maybe there are, instead of 1,000, 2,000 qualities of anything, and you are able to see only 1,000. If you have 1 million, I can say there are 2 million qualities to everything. So there is no end to this. It's an argument ad infinitum. And this creates an issue that we can know only as many senses as we have. Only that aspect of reality that our number of senses permit. And second, the sensitivity of our senses, how small or how big can they detect? So the quantitative aspect, the quantitative fineness, calibration, fineness of our senses. So there are, we have ears to hear, but many frequencies we cannot hear. We have eyes to see, but many colors we cannot see. Other animals can hear and see those things. So the limitation of number of senses and limitation of each of the sense, it creates a situation that we can only say that the way we see something is relative to our senses and their limitations. What we are seeing is into itself, we cannot say anything about. So the thing in itself can never be known with confidence that yes, this is all there is and there's nothing more to it. Because of these two arguments of limited number of senses and limitation of each sense. Therefore, the thing in itself cannot be known completely with confidence. We can only know what the senses report to us and what our brain can make out of that sensual information. So it may be the capacity of the brain or the capacity of the senses or the number of senses, whatever be the case, but we cannot know the thing in itself. We can only know how it appears to us. So we can only know the appearance of things based upon our senses. We cannot know what it is with confidence, the thing in itself. Now, when we apply this concept to psychoanalysis, it leads to very interesting things. One aspect of thinking itself is, it's the most fundamental thing. The second aspect of thinking itself is, it is unknowable. And the third aspect of thinking itself is existential. That not only we cannot know because of our sensual limitations, we also cannot know because knowing is not the same as the experience of an existence. And therefore, we have all the three attributes of the thing in itself. The most fundamental thing, what it is into itself, the unknowable, and the unknowable because of the existential problem of not knowing without existing what something else is. Now, these three problems are there. When you apply this to psychoanalysis, something interesting happens. Jung's concept of the self becomes almost like the thing in itself, the unknowable. And this unknowable is a structural component of the model of the mind. And so it's very alike the thing in itself, that it's the core, the most fundamental entity, but cannot be known. The core creates the other apparatus, but the apparatus cannot go inwards and know the core. So when you apply this thing in itself concept to Jung's self, you get a situation where the self is unknowable and the self creates the top apparatus. The apparatus can know all of the world, greatly itself to a great extent, but not its own source. So it's a structural component of thinking itself, very near to thinking itself, in the sense of something being fundamental and therefore unknowable. Look at Kohut's concept of self. Kohut says it's difficult to define self, and the self itself is unknowable. It's undefinable. So he uses the concept of self. The whole edifice is of self psychology, but the self itself is not completely definable and knowable. It gets into the unknowable aspect. But you here have the self, which is a manufactured construct. It is not inborn component of the mental apparatus like Jung's self is. And therefore, if something is manufactured, how can that be very fundamental and therefore unknowable? Which means the approach to look at Kohut's self as undefinable and unknowable has more to do with our own limitations of concept rather than something being ordained as a law of nature. Third, look at Bion's ineffable O. The root of transformation, as Bion calls it. That the ineffable O into itself is unknowable, but its repercussions can be felt in the system. So when transformation happens inside, the root of the transformation, the ineffable O, is unknowable, whereas its after effects can be felt in terms of the change. This again is very near to the thing in itself concept, but again, it only has a very conditioned unknowability to it. It's more of an unknown rather than a known, because the moment you look at something which is the result of a phenomena or the root of a phenomena, and it into itself, it is not a fundamental structural component of the psyche. All of that cannot be unknowable. Essentially, it is unknown. So it appears that Kohut's self and Bion's ineffable O appear like thing in itself, but they are not actually thing in itself. We have treated them like thing in itself and unknowable. Actually, they are not as unknowable as we think them to be. We have wrongly classified the unknown as unknowable and wrongly termed entities as thing in itself, which are not actually thing in itself. Whereas for Jung, the self is really a thing in itself. This kind of discussions, they open up new avenues of theorizing in terms of model of the mind, in terms of pathogenesis, and in terms of healing. And that's how it enriches the whole area when we bring in Immanuel Kant into psychoanalysis.
Is there a break between the subject and the object in Kant's philosophy? And how do Hegel and psychoanalysis respond to it?
It's a very interesting area because it brings us to what Kant was and what his times were. Kant is a person of precious balance. He is neither an individualist nor a collectivist. He is neither a nihilist nor a positivist. He is neither a religious believer nor he is an atheist. He is neither a hedonist nor he is a total moralist. Neither he is a kind of a purpose-oriented person like you, nor he is completely an origin-oriented person like Freud. It's a strange kind of a very precious balance that Immanuel Kant is. Now, one important aspect of Kant also is this, that Kant is a product of modernity in one sense. And that sense is that Kant sees reality as constituted of disjointed elements. He does not see reality as one organic whole with a purpose. So the Descartesian dichotomy of the subject and the object is very much at the center of Kant. That there is this knowing mind and there is the out there, the thing in itself. And the knowing mind tries to know as much as possible of the thing in itself, which cannot completely be known. But the knowing mind and the thing in itself are disjointed, independent, autonomous entities. They are not connected in any organic sense. And this creates a very deep sense of alienation. Because it is me versus the world out there, and we just happen to coexist. As Heidegger says, we are thrown into existence. So we find ourselves thrown into existence, and the world finds itself thrown into existence. And this thrownness is a disjointed absurdity, or if not absurdity, let me not use that word, but it's at least a disjointed happenstance. There is no design or purpose behind it. And this creates a very fundamental sense of alienation, that the man is not connected to the rest of the world in any organic sense. Now, this is quite at variance with the way spirituality looks at it, or in the way pre-modern philosophers look at man and nature being one unit. And just as the animals and plants in a symbiotic way constitute nature, we are also a component of nature. Slightly more evolved, but yet a component of nature in an organic way fused into nature, the way pre-modern man used to see himself. At least in the East, if not in the West. And this organicity is missing in Kant, and therefore alienation comes out in a very deep-rooted sense. And there is another aspect of it, that it is not good for any ideology, because once you say that no purpose is imminent in existence or in the human mind, grand ideologies go out of the window, because there is no destined place to reach. And in a sense, it can also be treated to be a founding ground for existentialism. But this also creates a very deep sense of alienation and purposelessness. It also creates moral relativism. And it also creates a very severe limit to what can be known and done with this world. Hegel addresses this problem by saying that the knower and the known are both parts of a larger system, the whole, and the whole is moving ahead with a purpose. And the knower, unknown to himself, is influenced by the spirit of the age. And the knower knows the known, fused with the spirit of the age. There is no independent knowing of the known. Like Heidegger says, that the consciousness is fused with the time into which it is. And Hegel creates this idea that there is a purpose, a grand design, and some law according to which human civilization is proceeding. And therefore, our lives are not insignificant, whatever we do. In no matter how small a way, we are all contributing in some way to a much grander purpose. And that grander purpose is there. There is a much grander design, a much grander intellect, much grander unity of an organic whole that is suffusing through everything, both the knower and the known. And the knower and the known are not disjointed. They are connected in some way into a larger organic system. And they are also not independent of each other. They influence each other to a great degree. So they are not disjointed, not independent. And Hegel creates this very important thing, and this is very important for psychoanalysis, because psychoanalysis initially was very much in the Kantian format of the child and the mother, or child and the parents, or the desire and the limitation put on desire. It was very much a dichotomous dyadic thing. Slowly, as we move from the Kantian spirit to the Hegelian spirit, social psychology comes in, that we are connected to a much larger organic whole, and that organic whole is connected to the world, and the world is connected to some spirit, and there is an organic unity and some organic purpose. And therefore, it leads to opening up the model of the mind to social influences, environmental influences, and also spiritual influences. So then the model of the mind just does not remain an individual's model of the mind. You will have to have some flow from society into the way the mind is getting created, the way the mind is operating, the way pathology is developing, the way healing is happening. So the individual model of the mind cannot remain individual model like we see in Freud and Jung, which was very much on the Kantian lines of the mind versus the environment. Now we see much open model of the mind when we bring Hegel in, that there has to be a flow from society, a flow from environment, and perhaps, if you believe, a spiritual flow into the way the mind operates. And this open model of the mind is where we get into what we get into the Hegelian spirit. Unfortunately, both models of the mind in psychoanalysis, and there are not many, very few are there. It's not easy to create a model of the mind. Very easy to go into process explanations. So I don't think, except for Freud and Jung, maybe a couple of people have attempted, but the most popular are Freud and Jung's models, the structural models of the mind. And there, they are with the Kantian spirit. But if we go into Hegelian spirit, we will end up with a open model of the mind, where social influences, environmental influences, occult and spiritual influences, they all will be there into a very dynamic, open, and not a two-way, but a multi-way traffic happening from, to, and across the mind. And this is something which the discussion on Kant and Hegel being brought into psychoanalysis opens up. In my heat model of the mind, I have brought in at least spirituality as one of the influences, and the social influence only in the mention. I have not been able to elaborate that, but that kind of modeling we'll have to get into to have more holistic and comprehensive model of the mind, more informed by the Hegelian spirit of organic unity, oneness, and multi-path flow of psychological entities or influences.
How does Indian spirituality respond to issues of Kant's concepts on knowing, knowability, and categorical imperative?
Indian spirituality has a very different take. Let us say the first concept of knowing. Kant's knowing essentially is the knowing that you and I know, the normal knowing, our everyday knowing, done with senses and the brain. There's nothing mystical about it. It seems very rational and scientific. In Indian spirituality, there are other ways of knowing apart from this way of knowing. And the other ways of knowing are, one, knowing by revelation. Second, knowing by transfer of consciousness, which is a very mystical thing, that some spiritual master who is about to go or pass away, he puts his consciousness and his knowledge and capabilities into somebody who is young. So this is called, or somebody who is enlightened provides enlightenment experience to somebody who is not. Or somebody on demand can induce a certain state of mind into somebody, which we call transfer of consciousness. And this second, knowing by transfer of consciousness, is second way that Indian spirituality believes in, but it's not found in Immanuel Kant. The third is knowledge by identity. That because the Indian spirituality believes in the five bodies, the knowing body or the astral body goes and identifies with what is to be known. And with that identity, the transfer of knowledge happens by intuition. So the third way of knowing, without using the sensory apparatus, it is knowledge by identity. The fourth way of knowing is by, in occult, what is called surrounding the object of knowing by one's consciousness, and that object in turn yields to us its knowledge. And that's an occult way of knowing. And this can be, occult way of knowing can be used for things where the sensory apparatus is inadequate or cannot reach. And the fifth way of knowing is knowing by grace, something that falls from above. The higher knowledge, the higher spiritual knowledge that falls from above, as it is put in the spiritual literature. So these five are very different forms of knowing in Indian spirituality compared to Immanuel Kant's way of knowing, his epistemological way of knowing. That is one. Second, what is the question? What is the second point of the question? You are muted, Supriya.
Knowability is the second.
Yeah, knowability. Or, and third kya hai? What is third?
Third is a categorical imperative.
Yeah. So knowability also is different in Indian spirituality and Immanuel Kant. The knowability sphere of Indian spirituality is wider than the knowability scope of Kant. Because one, as I said, there are many other modes of knowing, which Immanuel Kant has not taken into account, and almost rightly so, because these spiritual modes of knowing, which are not found in Immanuel Kant, they refer to rare experiences. Yeah, you were saying something.
Can we just take a small break, emergency here? Just okay. 2 minutes, yeah.
So the knowability is much larger, and because of one, as I said, the modes of knowing something are more than what Kant acknowledges or knows. Second, the knowability happens not only in ordinary states of consciousness, but in rare states of consciousness. For example, the states of no thought, the states of oceanic oneness, the states of astral travel, all these states, paranormal states, let us say, all these states, hallucinogenic states, all these states yield far more knowledge and expand the zone of knowability. And therefore, the scope of the known in Indian spirituality is much larger compared to Immanuel Kant. And the third element is of, what was the third element?
Categorical imperative.
Yeah. The take of Indian spirituality on the categorical imperative also is very different. Because Kant does not go into the manufacturing process of the categorical imperative. He just says it is inborn. But he does not go into the structural analysis of if there are any agency, is there any sort of psychological organ which is responsible for creating it, or is it just a process that happens and then stays as a stable process for the rest of the life? So it does not go into the manufacturing process. He just says it's inborn, it's always there, it is unconditional, very necessary and very precious, but does not go into how the categorical imperative comes to exist in our mind. Or what are the building blocks or ingredients of that categorical imperative? Or how does, in process terms, it operates? In Indian spirituality, there is a different take on it. The take is from the whole concept of the soul, what Sri Aurobindo calls the psychic, the soul in evolution. And the psychic puts out its agents at all the levels of the being, the physical level, the energy level, the psychological, the emotional level, the thought level. At every level, there is a representative of the self, the soul, and that is responsible for ethics at every level. And therefore, the categorical imperative is coming out of the soul, which has a huge amount of purity and morality inbuilt, goodness inbuilt, an intuitive perception of evil inbuilt, an intuitive tendency to create guilt and self-punishment inbuilt. And the execution happens by putting up a representative at every level. So that is how it goes into the manufacturing process of the morality and its operation. And this is where how it differs. And it also differs in the sense that over a period of many births, the categorical imperative slowly builds up in Indian spirituality. It is not a constant. Because we are talking of reincarnation, over reincarnation, it builds up and goes stronger and stronger. In general, in some people, of course, there are exceptions, but in general, there is development of soul and thereby also the development of the categorical imperative. Whereas in Immanuel Kant, the moment reincarnation goes out of the window, what you have is only one life, and therefore whatever is there is there. You can't talk of that developing further. You can't talk of that being there because of some past. It is just as it is there. It is as it is there, d'etrop, as the French philosophers call it. So it is there just as it is there. So this is how on knowability, the process of knowing and the categorical imperative, it is Indian spirituality has a much different take than Kant. And in terms of one more thing on categorical imperative, Indian spirituality puts a lot of emphasis on its development. If we look at any school of Indian spirituality, the most representative can be the Ashtanga Yoga of Patanjali. The Yam Niyam are very necessary. Before one gets into deeper roots of spirituality, that the building up of categorical imperative, the building up of conscience, of morality, of the superego, is a very essential part and almost the first part of the spiritual process. Before one gets into deeper parts of meditation, occult, life energy, and other self-exploratory practices.
How does Indian spirituality stand on the eternity of mathematical truths?
It is a very complicated question because Indian spirituality recognizes many different kinds of truths. There is an eternal fundamental truth, a spiritual truth, an evolutionary truth, a physical truth, a scientific truth, a practical truth, and a social truth. All these truths are recognized as truths by Indian spirituality. Of course, there is a hierarchy. Some are more revered than the other. But there is a hierarchy of truths and a whole, almost a menu of truths. And Therefore, the mathematical truth is one particular kind of truth. Now, when we talk of mathematical truth, there are many things that are covered. But two important points we can discuss. One important point is about the core concept of mathematics, which is the concept of equal to. That you have an equation and there's something on left hand side and something on right hand side. And this was also the argument of Hume, which Immanuel Kant took up. That mathematical truths have certainty. For example, when you say 2 plus 2 is equal to 4, we cannot think of any situation this is not going to be true. We can think of a situation that the sugar is not sweet, or iron is soft, or rubber is hard, but we cannot think that 2 plus 2 will not be equal to 4. Because 2 plus 2 and 4 are the same thing expressed differently on two sides of equal to. Now, Indian spirituality accepts this as a practical truth, as a Newtonian truth, but not as an absolute truth, because when we bring it to the level, to the aspect context of reality, as we see it, this equation does not hold. Because if I keep two apples on one side and two apples on the other side, I can keep equal to and say 2 is equal to 2. But these two apples I keep in the refrigerator and these two apples I keep in the open, and after 2 days, again I put them both together, I can still put equal to, because quantitatively they are equal. But qualitatively speaking, these two apples have rotten, are spoiled, and these two apples are fine. So they are not the same. So there is a quantitative truth to that equal to, but there is no qualitative truth to that equal to. Now when we go deeper, if we go into Buddha's philosophy, or even before him, the Vedic philosophy, which talks about eternal dynamism of the ceaselessness of Shakti in the manifest universe. All that is always in motion. There is a very good word in Gita, it's called Gati. That there is nothing in the manifest universe which is not in Gati. Everything is in Gati. Gati may be more or less, but the speed is there. Everything has a velocity. In the sense of change, not in the sense of physical motion, but in the sense of change. So everything is in the process of change. Buddha says you cannot put your feet in the same water twice. Because everything is in motion, next time you put your feet, it's a different water, it's not the same. And even if all the four apples were put in the refrigerator, they would still not be the same. Because they would perpetually, each of them will perpetually be in the process of change. And no two things are exactly equal. So unless two things are exactly at the same point, and internally and externally acted upon by same forces and same phenomena, equal to cannot hold in the real world. And therefore, because it is not possible that two things that exist separately cannot have the sameness completely. And therefore, X can only be equal to X. It can never be equal to Y. What you can have is X tending to Y. It can never be equal to Y. So those are the kind of things that philosophically Indian spirituality gets into in terms of the concept of mathematical truths. And this brings out an important element in the context that we are talking about, the tautological truths. What Wittgenstein later also refers to, that the real truths are empty truths, which don't talk about anything specific. And because they don't talk about anything specific, they remain eternal. And these are the kind of truths, right, that partly are accepted by Indian spirituality, partly not, because of this whole aspect of Gati and Shakti being perpetually in procession, and individuality and subjectivity being unique to all that exists. And therefore, these are the aspects of mathematical truths which are very dear to Immanuel Kant, but are accepted in a limited way in Indian spirituality.
This was a very interesting explanation. Now we move to our next question. Does Kant's discourse of self, the thing in itself, morality and justice, create problems conceptually or in the area of living itself?
Yes, it does. Like every philosopher, Kant solves problems and he leaves behind problems. And that is true of every school and spiritual school, every school of philosophy and spirituality. That every school that is created solves some problems and leaves behind some problems for the next generation. So, individuals are not perfect and no theory is perfect. And at times you feel gladly so, because if somebody comes up with a theory of everything, what will the next generation do? There will be a problem of an eternal psychological unemployment. So this also is an issue. And Kant's work leaves behind these issues. One is the issue of alienation. And this issue of alienation can easily lead to exploitation of environment and moral relativism, because it poses I versus the world. I and the world are not in one organic unity. There's nothing connecting the two. And if there's nothing connecting the two, the only thing that operates between the two is self-interest. And this morality of conviction is hardly a capable enough or strong enough element to hold back difficult desires of human beings. So first it creates alienation. Alienation can easily become a recipe for non-sustainability and environmental degradation. It also throws out of the window grand ideologies and purpose which human beings are so desperate for. It's a philosophy for the stoic. It is not philosophy for the warm-hearted, the optimistic, who want some grand vision for which they can dedicate their lives or give a purpose to their lives, no matter even if they are with these purposes are with limitations. So it is not conducive to ideologies, and ideologies, just as they create tragedies, they also contribute a lot, both at the individual and social level. So that's one difficulty with the thing in itself stuff. The second difficulty is with morality. Kant's morality is based on categorical imperative and personal conviction. It is not based upon reward and punishment. And that is a very difficult thing to practice from the social scale. This morality is actually morality of philosophers. It is not the morality of masses. When you come to the masses, you need some sort of reward punishment framework to keep people in check. Because if you expect everyone to practice morality of conviction, the id is too strong to be held back by morality of conviction. So without using repression, without using very draconian measures inside and outside, it's very difficult to rein in the id, its libidinal infinite desires and its rage and this mad aggression. The force of the desire, the force of pathology is so high that unless you have very draconian measures inside and outside to some extent, it is not possible to rein in ourselves purely by the force of conviction. And that is where the social applicability of Kant gets in question. And the third element is, what was the third thing? I forgot.
Justice.
Justice also is difficult because Kant, when he talks about justice, he indirectly talks about life after death. He talks about reincarnation. And otherwise, when he talks about, he does not refer to the reincarnation so much. We almost feel as though we are dealing with a rational person and reincarnation has gone out of the window. So when he talks about the epistemology, it does not come in. It's out of the window. When he talks about ethics, it comes in. And even when it comes in a token way as though to support the otherwise weak conviction that we have. It's almost like augmenting the inadequate strength of conviction that we have, that it comes in. Does not come in with the lightning and thunder. It comes in very weakly, almost with a hesitation. And this can easily lead to a moral relativism. Because once you say goodbye to any religious or spiritual authority, two things happen. One, there are differences of ideas on what is ethical. And second, even after deciding on what is ethical, you can have clashes based upon that. But even after that, let's say there are no clashes, the practice becomes very difficult because of inadequate strength of conviction versus the desire and pathology. So those things on social level again become problems. And therefore, these three things, when you put into practice, you get into problems with Immanuel Kant. And obviously, Hegel tried to solve some of these problems of alienation, of organicity, of purpose, of ideology, of spirit of the times, of the goal of the civilization. And Indian spirituality has a slightly different take because it talks about justice as being perfect, but not only on earth, not only in this incarnation. So the time span increases to many incarnations and the spatial zone increases to other zones of existence of the soul after death. So the terrestrial zone has imperfect justice. There is some justice. It's not that there is no justice, but it's imperfect justice. But totality as a whole, there is the concept of a perfect justice.
We come to our last question. How do you think a profound discourse of Kant and psychoanalysis can really enrich psychoanalysis?
In many ways, I think philosophy has not been brought adequately into psychoanalysis. Where it can be brought in is one, in the model of the mind, two, in the process of thinking, three, in the elemental entities that are involved in all psychological processes, fourth, in terms of the purpose of life. And these are some of the areas where it can be brought in. And at least from Kant, we can bring in, if not anything else, the epistemological process in all the critical psychoanalytic phenomena that we see. In terms of the pathology generation phenomena, and in terms of the healing phenomena in the therapy room, or even outside of the therapy room. So this is the core where it can enrich psychoanalysis. Conceptually speaking, a lot can be done in the metapsychology in psychoanalysis. So the nearest to metapsychology is the philosophy of the mind, and of which epistemology will be a part. This philosophy of the mind, epistemology, can be brought into metapsychology, into integration of various schools of psychoanalysis, whatever part we can integrate. and into integration of therapy processes, if there are some overarching concepts we can find in the zone of philosophy of mind. My feeling is, if these things are brought in philosophy of mind, enriching metapsychology, and enriching the psychological processes with epistemology and with purpose of healing. If you get this into training of people in psychoanalysis, they will come out with a far broader mind space than the kind of truncated mind space they come out with. I have been a very strong critic of the narrowness and the very pessimistic, narrow, reductionist and focused mindset that psychoanalysts come out with, and much of it has to do with the trauma of supervision. Then the supervisor straitjacket them into what I call the CCC, the castrated confirming characters. That the supervisors castrate them so much and force them into conformity that they come out as CCC, the castrated confirming characters. And there was a quote by a lady who was in her 70s, late 70s, that she really became free of the influence of the supervisors and came into herself only in her late 50s and 60s. And this is the depth to which it goes. And my personal belief is that if you bring in philosophy, it will get in far more flexibility, far more openness, and far more confidence, and expanded psychological horizon for psychotherapists and psychoanalysts who are coming out. Lastly, it will, as I said before, it will definitely enrich the core components of psychoanalysis, be it metapsychology, model of the mind, pathogenesis, healing, and most importantly, creating tools for healing, which we have not done adequately enough.
Thank you, Himanshuji. Today we have discussed a very profound and complex topic, but it has brought a lot of clarity and usefulness and enrichment for people who are interested in confluence between philosophy and psychology.
Right.
Thank you for your discourse. Do write to us at hvindia@gmail.com. Namaste.
Namaste.